So this is our second meeting, and something that we wanted to articulate that maybe didn't come through as well last week was that we like to kind of encourage more discussion than just kind of like lecturing at you guys. So feel free to ask questions. I think Devin's okay if you stop in and ask questions.
I would prefer to.
Yeah, so we like to generate discussion, so you are more than welcome to do that. So for tonight, we have Devin Curry. He has a bachelor's in microbiology and a PhD in bacterial genetic engineering. During his graduate career, Devin worked on engineering microbes to convert plant biomass into liquid fuels. And now as a postdoc here at MIT in the chemical engineering department, Devin works on the microbial and process engineering to convert solid municipal waste into biodiesel.
All right, so I'm serious. I really do want you guys to like ask me questions. More fun that way. I can sit and drone on for a while. So in essentially said, my background is as a microbiologist with a very heavily applied sort of bend to it, particularly the realm of chemical engineering. So that's the space in which I work and the space in which I can answer your questions most clearly, but I'm fairly well versed in a number of things, so feel free to ask me anything about the technology I'm going to tell you about in this sort of space. So I want to briefly touch upon the Tata Center, which funds me and my work. I don't know, how aware of the center are you guys at all? To 0 to 100%? Not at all. Okay, good, perfect. The slide is not out of place. So it was founded in 2012 via a donation from the Tata Trusts. We've got six focal areas, and these are agriculture, energy, health, housing, water, and waste. Each one of these is headed up by a couple of faculty members, then a postdoc lead. I'm the postdoc lead of the waste group, and then we have PhD and master's students as part of that, and the center as a whole has year offs, but also paper running. We've got approximately 40 faculty members at this point, which is pretty good. But basically across the entire institution, 10 postdocs, staff. Our goal is to develop an engineering discipline that focuses on high value to cost ratio. So we, cheap is not the right word, but things that are appropriately priced for the technology that we're trying to bring to bear. As I said, we're primarily focused in India, but that's not our only areas of the developing world underserved areas. And we have just launched a sister program at IIT Bombay, Mumbai, or Bombay, this summer. So waste to energy. Why? Well, it's been argued that energy is probably the biggest challenge we face as a species in the coming 100 years. From a process design standpoint, if you want to make a fuel, you really have to start with a very low value feedstock. Right now, we can power our civilization based on fossil fuels because that feedstock is, you just have to pump it out of the ground, burn 15% of it to refine it, all of the streams we produce, and then it's done. So it's almost, it's free, basically. And the same needs to be true for anything moving forward that's green or renewable. So the nice thing about waste is that its price points are, in some cases you have to pay a small amount of money per ton or per unit. Belt worlds, frequently countries will pay, or countries and municipalities will pay you, the processor of waste to get rid of it, so it can be a negative value, which is really nice. And so this really fulfills the feedstock requirement. Waste streams in India are complex. So here's some MSW, municipal solid waste, in a dumpster in India, small dump. And these are generated in homes and then flow through a system that I'm going to try and outline for you. So initially, there is a sort phase when you're kind of trying to process out these waste streams and get them into individual pure streams or atoms that you go down to the pump. The sort phase can occur in the home by the generator, which is rare, or can occur at the point of collection, which is still somewhat rare. By either waste pickers or a company that a municipal corporation might hire. Out of this, recyclables are one, and then there is mixed waste. I will note that the thickness of these arrows more or less represents the amount of product flowing through that particular pathway. So we can move forward and then just look at these two. There's an additional sort phase. This can either be done by humans or mechanically. The mechanical solution is not very good. In India, it's really not very good. Even in the West, where people have developed really high-tech sorting solutions, they just cost a lot of money. In India, it's something that looks like this. It's a giant rolling wheel with holes in it, and it spins, and heavy things fall out. Organic waste is more or less enriched in the stream coming out. It only gets up to about 60% organics. The rest of them are plastic bags, and like that gets into this final waste stream. So the recyclables, you get things like plastics, metals, components, and these can just be sold for profit. On the mixed waste, it's a little more complex. Cellulosics, cellulosic is a term that is not in the spelling of cellulose, as many people have commented, but is in fact a term to encompass plant matter, broad. Food waste, other energy carriers, recyclables and plastic, and finally things that we class as unusable. Stuff that just needs to be landfilled. So we can get rid of the stuff we've sold and just look at these waste streams. There are three primary ways to process waste into energy, and they are a bioactivation type process, which is what I work on. There's incineration, and then there is thermal type processes. These are torrefactions, gasifications. We can ignore the unusable, obviously. Just look at where each one of these waste streams will feed into these processes. The cellulosics can go into all three. They're pretty broad. Food waste, on the other hand, is wet. And because of that very high moisture content, it is inappropriate for incineration or the thermal processes without a lot of drying. And that costs money and makes it slow. And generally, you don't want to have to spend time drying food waste just to burn. So bioactivation is very food wastes. Other energy carriers you might as well just burn. These are things like little scraps of plastic bags and that sort of stuff that you're never going to be able to recycle in any kind of real way. In incineration, plastic bags are actually used as a binder to make pellets that you burn. And so it's actually essential that plastic bags are in the waste stream. Before I continue on, while we're going through incineration, I know at sort of gut level incineration feels bad. And no one wants to just burn a bunch of trash. That being said, I as an engineer need to keep all these things on the table. I can't just dismiss something because I feel bad about it. We need to look at all of these, figure out which it may be that I'm wrong. Bioactivation is not the most environmentally friendly path if sufficient scrubbing is performed on incineration. And without actually investigating that, dismiss it. And so I always make sure to leave these other options up, although they are my personal thing. The recyclables in plastics, these are bigger plastics. Once again, you can just burn them and send them through thermal processes for you, and you can sell them for cash. The stuff that comes out of these, for bioactivation, the big one is biogas. Most people have heard of biogas. I'm going to talk a lot about biogas because it's a very similar process to what we do. Biogas can be used either immediately, it can be packaged, or it can be converted into other fuels. This is either chemically or biologically, which our lab has another effort on. Liquid fuels, this is basically what I work on here. This is a new and novel sort of process, so there's no literature really on it. You can make ethanol from food waste, but it doesn't work very well. And finally, you can compost it. I'd like to point out something interesting about compost, which is that in the composting process, you burn about 80% of your carbon-carbon bonds to CO2, so that's a bunch of wasted energy that you just dump into the atmosphere. And the compost itself, the equivalent either by weight, volume, whatever, compares to the fuel that you might make, which you'll also still burn all of the CO2. The difference is 5 times more value out of the fuel than out of the compost. And there's not a really good reason to do large-scale compost. It's your waste. syngas back out. Syngas are synthesis gases, a mix of hydrogen, CO2, and carbon monoxide. And syngas is really cool, and you can feed it into biological processes or into other thermal processes. And finally, you can produce solid fuel. These would be things like charcoal. For all of these things, for each one of these to work, you basically need one thing that's high energy bonds. For the biological side of things, you need stuff like sugars, lipids, protein, starch. These are primarily your food sort of energy sources. And then cellulose and xylan. These are plants, of course. Neither of them we can use, although we do like eating salads. The current technologies to biologically produce fuel, or I'm sorry, the current technologies out there for fuel production in general look like this. There's RDF, which is refuse-derived fuel. This is sawdust, but you do this with trash as well. You compress your feedstock into briquettes, you burn it in a big incinerator, and then you power a steam turbine and generate electricity. Fischer-Tropsch is a technology that's been around for a long time. While on a very simple process diagram, it's straightforward and easy. You know that you go through syngas here, that's one of those potential feedbacks for syngas. In actuality, it is a very complex process and it's extremely capital intensive under any of our current actual working sort of process designs. It's really, really, really pricey. The only time this Fischer-Tropsch has really been implemented are places where a company can get free feedstock. So Middle Eastern companies will contract with BP or someone and say, okay, build a Fischer-Tropsch plant here. They'll give you free methane for a decade or something. And that's how you can balance the cost of this. Otherwise, it's just too expensive. And finally, biogas. Biogas is roughly 60% methane, 40% CO2. It's a pretty simple process. You take waste, you sort it, pre-treat it, you dump it into a pit in the ground. This then generates methane and other gases. Out of this comes a feed of basically scentless fertilizers. So we are still producing something that's like compost in biogas or our process. I know scentless because I got sprayed with some of this at a biogas facility because they were all excited to show me how scentless the fertilizer were. Kicked open a valve which was stuck in the sprayed one of my coworkers and I can attest that it was scentless, but the other thing is the biogas, which first needs to be scrubbed, pull out all that CO2. All the CO2 makes it burn very poorly, it's burned right up out of the reactor. So you need to scrub the CO2 and also hydrogen sulfide, which is a small component of biogas. And then you just compress it for burning. I'm going to go through kind of very slowly how biogas and biogasification works, because the process is very similar to ours. And to understand our technology, you kind of need to understand the biogas technology itself. So the species involved in biogasification. On the bacterial side of things, and this is going to build up a tree of life, on the deconstruction of the starches, the lipids, the cellulose, xylan, that's a bacterial process primarily. And so things like gram-positive and proteobacters are primarily driving that, and they produce volatile fatty acids. These volatile fatty acids will eventually, the eukaryotes do nothing. Fungus, not much. But then the archaea are the bugs that actually produce the methane. They're a separate branch of life that interesting biologically. So the gram-positive and the proteobacter spit out these volatile fatty acids. These are things like acetic acid, propionic acid, so vinegar, propionic acid is kind of what it is. Vinegar is the one you know best. The methanogens, things like methanobacteria, methanococcus, anything that starts with meth in here is methanogen, take out those volatile fatty acids and then spit out methane. So the first step, anaerobic digestion, they're breaking down all these parts, is basically bacterial fermentation. We call it anaerobic digestion. It's just a fermentation, but instead of making ethanol, that you would have wine or beer fermentation if you're making. A couple of things, hydrogen, CO2, and the short chain polyolefin acids. The pathways to get to these products are very numerous and don't all exist in one molecule. This is sort of a synthesis of starting from glucose. Most things will eventually feed into glucose, so there are other routes into central metabolism of microbes. They then branch off and produce all these little small molecules that we can feed. The diversity to do this is really interesting. It's one of the really great points about using biology in any industrial process. This is kind of a complex figure that I've looked at from a paper. The idea here is that each one of these columns represents a time point in the life of a bioreactor, in a biodigester. That's anaerobically digesting food, waste, yard waste, that sort of thing. The size of each one of these boxes represents the total number of sequencing reads for a given species. So it's basically counting how many of a certain microbe are present at any given time. Probably any coherent size. It doesn't inform that much. The important thing to know is that as feedstocks change and times change, the population that's present in each one of these things shifts pretty wildly. Now, if I was, and the result, the reason for this is, say, you know, on this day, I had a bunch of yard waste, grass clippings, and tree branches that I fed into my biodigester. On this day, maybe I got in a ton of calzones that went bad with fat or something. If this was a chemical process, I would then have to be very careful in adjusting how this process was running, because the feedstocks are now wildly different. For the biological process, the species needed to break down each one of these feedstocks are basically present at all times, and they just expand, their populations expand and contract as they encounter different substrates. The classic, yeah.
What's on the
So on the x-axis, each one of these is a different, so like these guys, numbers of reads and that sort of stuff. So those are, they're not particularly important. Number of reads is just a metric in this figure of how confident you can be in these numbers. If the numbers of reads, you know, if they had exactly 15 reads and had 15 counts, then perhaps this data set. In this case, there are about 1,000, so you feel very confident. Sample sufficient in order to make the call on the prevalent of each one of these species under conditions. Food waste is easy to break down, and it's kind of the thing that I've talked most about, but if you remember in the high energy bond chart, there was cellulose. Cellulose really drags out the solid hydraulic retention time on a reactor. You go from something like 5 days to go through all of this stuff in a reactor on a given scale, something like 30 recycles. The reason for this, and I don't necessarily have to go through this slide, but I want to step through it quickly, is that the mechanism to degrade cellulose is incredibly complex. And it's a very large extracellular protein scaffold in the most successful organisms that organize the enzyme. Organize all these various enzymes to break down substrates that, you know, most bugs make something between 10 and 60 different enzymes that can put on one of these scaffolds. They then go and sit down on the surface of cellulose and slowly degrade it away and take up the sugars that are now solubilized. The difference between something like this and working on food waste, basically everything's broken down. We're talking about free sugars. All the bugs have to do is pull in the sugars. For this reason, that things like cellulose and ethanol are hard and not easy. I come from cellulose and ethanol as my PhD background. Cellulose is very recalcitrant, and it's a large extracellular mass. So if you want to capture all of this energy that's in cellulose, and cellulose is just glucose, beta 1,4-dihydroxybutyrate, and so it's a very high energy feed. Yeah.
I'm just curious, what about lignin?
Lignin almost. The only thing that can do anything to lignin is like white and brown rock fungus. The problem with any industrial application for lignin breakdown is that unless you're looking at it as just a waste stream that you need to get rid of, you can't recapture almost any value from it. Imagine the scenarios that you have now. The reason for this is that the way to break lignin down, the way lignin is a randomly assembled sort of that heteropolymer mesh. To break it down, every mechanism that anyone's ever found requires oxygen. Hydrogen peroxide is a peroxidase. That's actually pumped outside the cell. They fed hydrogen peroxide, and that breaks down this network. All of these microbes would die in the presence of that hydrogen peroxide, that's pumped oxygen effectively, and all of that oxygen spills into these networks. And so that's if you want to make a high value product, growing something aerobically is not going to get used to make a lot of CO2, because then they have they can undergo transport chains and they just dump out CO2 and make more cells. Fermentation, the only reason you get high energy compounds out of the graphene, and that's what it's called, is because you forced the microbes to run fermentation and such a phosphorylation, that sort of thing, which because of the nature of that process, they can't gain all of the energy back out of those sugars, whatever it is. The result is a waste stream as far as the microbe is concerned that still has a lot of energy content. All the fatty acids are in our eggs and everything like that. So, interestingly, methanogenesis, which is that second part that actually makes the methane in these bioreactors, is comparatively much simpler. You can break down into two classes, you can see a plastic. So these guys take up those organic acids that we're trying to use and use them for their native metabolism. And then these guys use the hydrogen and CO2 that are also produced in the end of the digestion to methane. All of them, as I said, produce methane. The process is incredibly complex, relying on some really interesting enzymology that is extremely, extremely, extremely oxygen sensitive and is also very sensitive to pH. Methanogens can't grow below a pH of 6, and that would be an important thing to note as a key part of the technology. The diversity of archaea in a bioreactor, however, is a lot lower, which is interesting. We're really talking about two main groups with splinter ones off to the side to do some kind of interesting reactions, but other than that, basically just the seed plastic. So biogas, what's the actual energy breakdown? Well, if we assume that trash has 100% of its energy, the resulting methane only contains 60% of that available energy. As I noted, and I just want to keep driving this home, volatile fatty acids are the carrier in between basically the trash. The microbes produce these volatile fatty acids. Second set produces the methane. The remaining 40% goes to CO2. CO2 is effectively inert. So current biogas applications, these you probably know, you can power vehicles, trains, you can make electricity by just burning the biogas directly to power things like municipal streetlights and things. They use it for cooking, and you can use it for vehicles. Same things you use natural gas for, it's just termed biogas. As I said, we don't think that the current process capturing all of the energy. It's all about that CO2 being kicked out from them. And there's a natural system that you can look at that feels the same way we do, and that's the cap. Cows are actually a really great natural model of anaerobic digestion, and a lot of what we know about anaerobic digestion comes from studying rumen fluid from cows. So here's your cow. They eat grass. That grass goes into the rumen, there's a large microbial population there, they produce volatile fatty acids. A cow, then, because it wants to make more cow, sucks up those volatile fatty acids and uses it to make more cow. The same is true for us, actually. A lot of the energy we actually get to use out of the food we eat has already passed through our native microflora, and we've taken out of those volatile fatty acids, and also from our population. methanogens are a parasite. The reason for this is that the methanogens that are present in the rumen are trying to suck up those volatile fatty acids as well to keep them. They do that, they suck away the acids from the cow and produce methane, which is biologically a mirror effect, as far as the cow's concerned. There are methanotrophs, but they're rare. So this is how we do methane, that this is a waste product and we can do something better with it. Ours is make more fuel. Our process looks like this. We start with trash. We mechanically disrupt it to increase the surface area. So now we're talking a fairly small particle size. This is true for biogasification as well. And we just grind it up in the sun there. We then dump that into an anaerobic digester. Out of that anaerobic digester, and our process in its current, the way we had it set up currently is an iterative batch rather than a continuous process, which biogases. Designed around, although there are some batch biogas plants. It's not that important, just having a stress process over time. I'm happy to tell you why after order. So you take the slurry that comes out of this after 5-10 days. This is liquid that has all these volatile fatty acids kicking around it, and also residual sludge that we've put in the digester. The reason we're maintaining all those volatile fatty acids here and not making biogas is that in the anaerobic digester, we drive the pH down to below 6, which kills the methanogens. So now, instead of producing methane, you just end up with that intermediate, which is what we want to use in the downstream process. So we separate out the liquid phase from the solids. The solids go to things like fertilizer, just as they would in biogasification, but then the volatile fatty acid supernatant. Supernatant just refers to anything that's liquid phase above a solid phase. So if a supernatant is then fed to a second aerobic reactor, I'm going to be purposely vague here. I apologize, but just refer to this as aerobic reactor. You can probably figure out what's in it. And from this, we get lipids. Things like, and these are triglycerides. 16 to 18 carbon chain in length. And I'll come back to that, but basically this is our fuel that we're producing as opposed to getting a gas, which has to be bottled and compressed. As a part of this, we can also produce animal feed from these microbes, although they are transgenic, which some people are concerned about. There's no reason for it. These lipids we then take transesterification is really easy, simple process that is a little capital intensive but isn't particularly complex. Basically, what you're doing is a triglyceride is a glycerol cap, more or less, that has three chains of carbon, hydrocarbons stuck to the end. Transesterification hacks off the cap, you take the glycerol and feed it back into your aerobic reactor, which then serves as a new cap for new triglyceride production. And then you get out our basically biodiesel. It's exactly the same thing that normal biodiesel is now. So cooking grease is just triglycerides. You transesterify it in the exact same way we do. The result is a drop in biofuel mix. You can actually burn it straight in engine, although the acidity does eat away with certain plastics in engines. So if you mix it 28 with regular diesel, you can just burn it, no problem. If you try and burn it just as is, you'll need to replace some of the fittings in the engine, but it's easily done. It's just a different process to make sure you don't destroy it. So to compare the two processes, temperature ranges, all these things are very similar. The only big differences are the pH, and the pH is, of course, in the anaerobic digester to force methanogenesis to not occur. The oxygen content. We can tolerate a little bit more oxygen. Methanogens are very, very, very oxygen sensitive. A point in favor for a technology like this versus biogas is that biogas plants have a tendency to go off kilter. too much sugar into a body at that point. That first volatile fatty acid producing phase goes too quickly for bacteria, eat a ton of sugar, put out a ton of volatile fatty acids, and all those volatile fatty acids then drive the pH of the reactor down below 6. When that happens, your methanogenesis stops and you're not making biogas anymore. You need to dump in a bunch of sort of hydroxide or some other base to bring your reactor back up. So companies have gone bankrupt because they can't get this feed just right. For us, we don't care. We just hold the pH above 5 someplace, and there are easy ways to do this. I use calcium carbonate because it dissolves as the pH drops, and so this offline buffering is basically as freeze you can get. It's not a real buffer, it's one of the pH push back up. But we don't have to worry about crashing out the pH. We want it to just need to increase all the fatty acids. If we were to allow the process to run rapid, the pH drops down to 3 and kills everything. And so that's why we do have to push it back up. But it's very easy.
For biogas, you had a list of kind of potential uses. Mm-hmm. You could use biogas for lipids. Are they the same applications?
Basically, yeah. The really big benefit to lipids over gases is that gases are hard to transport, they're hard to distribute, if you're not in a pipeline, they're challenging, you're then going for local onset compression, you have to move this around, there's a lot of loss associated with gases, hydrogen being a classic example of a bad idea in fuel sources, you burn up 4% of just the losses, you're trying to move this stuff around. This thing is super metal. I don't know if it's quite as bad as hydrogen. It's not quite so crappy. But for lipids, or any liquid fuel, you just dump a bucket, it's not going to escape and run off on you. It fits in very nicely with our current distribution technologies. Cheap trucks as opposed to high pressure vehicles. All of that. So there's a lot of good that can come from going to the liquid fuel versus a gas fuel.
In terms of like the efficiency, I think that one is worth at 60%. And also the cost.
Yep. So, for which one?
For lipids.
So, this is the biodiesel is a little bit. We're currently working through the economics. At the moment, and actually. So, we think we're going to be. At the moment, we're somewhere above 7. So, we're definitely better than, as far as energy conservation goes. Cost-wise, we're about on par with biodiesel or current methane. So we're in a good space. We want to be better, obviously. Why hover around biogas if we can? Because we think we can, but it's going to require some additional engineering in the organism used in the aerobic lipid production reactor. There are some pretty easy theoretical big gains we can make from doing a couple of different things in that organism. So we're fairly confident we can get above the current conversion rate, which is something like 17% of all the fatty acids are converted to lipids. If we can drive it up near the 30%, we're in a very profitable, both energy conservation wise and money wise.
On the cost, the cost analysis that you're looking at is just in the production, not in, say, the comparison with transporting and storing the...
No, they're all included. So,
oh, it is, okay.
So we have a couple of different people working on this. Sagar's working on the distribution of transporting where we sell it. Marina, who you may not have met, another lab member who's working on the cost of building a facility, running a facility, how it compares to a biogas plant. Ours, obviously, is more technological complex, but not vastly more technological complex. The nice thing about biogas facilities is they are ridiculously cheap. It's a pit in the ground, basically. With some pumps for us in the centrifuge and the conical center. The big cost in ours is the second reactor, which is the aerobic. Keeping something counterintuitive. In a big industrial process, the gets a little oxygen, gets more energy for itself, using it is what we need to suck it all up. Yeah. So I'll really quickly step through some of the sort of actual research questions we're looking at the moment, and I've stripped these down pretty far, so I apologize. So we want to know how important is inocular. These communities are obviously very important and change radically. Given the insights, we want to know, is inocular going to be important, or are we going to have to really pay attention? Inocular just means the microbes are coming in the process. What's the DEFA, well, biosphere profile for different waste streams? Because no one really makes volatile fatty acids as their sole goal. There's not a lot of data out there, despite the similarities between us and biogas. What's the optimal time frame for these guys? Can we drop? How far can we decrease the solid retention time in this process versus biogas, where biogas you have a whole second violent step to occur at the same time? Can we drive these down to 5 day retention times, 7 day retention times, as opposed to 15 or 30 that we might see in a biogas facility? And finally, our inhibitors from the waste or fermentation are concerned. One of the nice things about this process is that we're using all of the extra micronutrients and salts and that sort of thing that comes in the initial waste stream as the additional food source for the aerobic reactor. Normally you would have to pay for these things. In the US, it's corn steep flicker. You can buy a trainload of corn steep flicker and basically has this your catch all. Dump that in there. Everybody likes corn steep flicker. In this case, we just use the liquid from the trash as part of that. The problem with doing that is we don't know what's all in the trash. And there are liquid compounds that are produced in many different biological processes that might restrict the growth of our second plants. But first, the production versus inoculum, and we've done this with a bunch of different things, but the take-home message is, while there have been a number of studies showing that the community needed to dry down our digestion up is present in the waste as it comes into one of these facilities, dumping in things like activated sludge really speed it up. It wasn't a big surprise, but it's nice to see our activated sludge we get from Deer Island. It's just dried out there. For those of you who all know what Deer Island is, and it's Boston's wastewater processing facility. If you go out in the harbor, there are these big egg-shaped structures, and that's where Boston processes all its wastewater. We'll happily give you liters upon liters of activated sludge to do whatever I guess you want. Waste streams. So we wanted to look at a couple of different things. Food waste is the most obvious. I collect food waste from basically stock. Mine it out of a trash can. It's actually not as bad as you think. It smells really good. It smells like food still. I mean, it's starting to bubble from all the metabolic action and heat and microbial growth that's going on it. And then I harvest it, they dump it in this big, big trash can every night. That's pretty awful. But it smells like food, so that's not the worst. The grass and sticks and twigs are a little bit more challenging to get. There's a facility on my team runs where they collect all these things on site, and you get like an ID badge, and you have to go and crawl around in a dumpster, and then there's a metal bar to activate the trip to get back out of the thing. You get trapped in there. We found out the first time we went. So we wanted to test all of these, and then we wanted to test a mix of these, and one-to-one-to-one seemed like a reasonable enough ratio for runs for these. The result is looking at volatile fatty acid production. These are HPLC data coming out of biological triplicates over there. This is a single time point, but we have these running for 30 days, sampled once a day, both static and shaken. I will say that mixing speeds up the process, but it isn't necessary to get to where we want to go. This is important for us on the sort of how can I build a good facility level. You still have to mix the crap out of this. It's going to cost a lot of money. But if I just let it sit there, it costs nothing. So these data spikes here is because there's another group of archaea that you mentioned, that use methanol as a feedstock for the result is, yes, we're making a lot of carbon acids, enough to make this process economic. We're in line with the few sketchy reports that do exist, that we've gotten out of companies for, hey, what do you think the amount of carbon acids is? Using our maybe back calculating, starting from the amount of methane physically produced, the amount of food they produce, and make certain assumptions about the integration rate. We're basically writing carbon out of that, which is great. It doesn't look like holding. Finally, the version of the it is a microbe, that's about all I need to tell you about the second reactor. But the result is that, yes, it grows on it, although there is certainly some inhibition, and we're still trying to figure out exactly why. And this is a kind of comparison to some of these comparing the dose which is either way, it's very, very encouraging for us. We do these kind of experiments small scale, in serum, in little serum models. We're using those only two of these, so the third one is experiment exploring different pressure. Knowing my life, that's why I would probably be excited about this. This is what exactly the food waste looks like in the pork stuff. It's mostly the meat, so it's awesome. It smells like students. We're also doing a larger scale work with bioreactors. Bioreactors are the second process. Normally, you can watch them. I don't want to try to learn a few days. So to address that, we have started some work at the medium scale of this is a very cheap home-built reactor. It looks cheap home-built. Basically a water jacket, so keep the temperature set in the bucket. But given our stated goal that what we want to do is build a technology that can be implemented for very, very, very little money and distributed back to the media or in the rest of the world, this is actually sort of the technological level we need to be at if we want to do this in a financial sense. It works is the sort of the next take home from this trash reactor. Finally, we're trying to do this in India as well. So we want to scale. Just show people function first. And you can get a lot of money very easily to pilot scale something for us pilot scale something hundreds of years, so to scale. So you need to show something that you can do this. You need to get to see whether or not. And so to do this, we have a collaboration with ISCFF. They have very generously given us space. In this photo, this looks really nice. It's not. It's called the F1 shed. It is actually a shed, just a shed. You can use some weird gasified coal because our little habitat is in this lab. What we're trying to do is build these sort of really cheap custom parts. In lab, when I want to grind up sticks and twigs, mechanical disruption, I have a very, very high power blender. If any of the Willard Blend videos, you know, those fire labs, I bought one of those blenders. So I was like, how am I going to grind up three branches? animals at this point are gonna get better, we can get better, we have time, we can check, it's not impossible. Biogasic, CO2, and that information, it's a lot. Finally, I'd like to acknowledge my whole lab, but very specifically a couple of people, Sawyer and Alex. Alex is a very, very good, you're a 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 good